good.
Yeah.
Well, I certainly want to thank the organizers, John, I guess, OBC, Chad also, and of course Travis, our guys, Rob House, Mark Williams. I see some friendly faces here, Coaster Kids. It was well, but it was good to see you guys. You know, I take these opportunities to learn a little bit. Okay? Now, I'm sure there's an elephant in the room. You want to get rid of the elephant in the room? What's your next coaster, Abe? Okay. We'll talk about that later. Let's get rid of the elephant in the room. I also understand you're going to do some last rides today. Do you know the rides that you're riding? Have that been announced yet? Okay. Well, it's going to be Lightning Run for sure. Cyclops, but what's really interesting is we're going to have the last hurrah for the Enterprise. The Enterprise is a ride I bought in 1990 with the original car. It's a hearse ride. And we're retiring the Enterprise, so you all will be on the last ride of the Enterprise. Every ride has its own life cycle. That ride is almost 25 years old now, in terms of being in operation. And we get a little concerned when we hit that point, when a ride gets to be that age. Also, it's very, very difficult to replace the parts in the hydraulic motors anymore. So, we're going to put that in North Pole. It's been a great run for the Enterprise, and you'll have the best ride. Let me ask you guys a question. You know, I noticed that the Beast, I had occasion to review the top 50 wooden coasters, top 50 steel coasters in this year's Golden Globe Award. And it's interesting. By my count, and I wrote it down this morning, I want to share it with you, it's interesting. So Cedar Point had four steel coasters. I'm only talking about the steel coasters. Cedar Point had four steel coasters in the top 50. Magic Mountain, understanding, yeah, had three coasters in the top 50. You know, young man, you want to come up with that? I can't hear myself. Thank you. Appreciate that. So again, Cedar Point had four in the top 50. Magic Mountain had three in the top 50. Busch Gardens, Tampa had three. Busch Gardens, Williamsburg had three. That's it. Only four parks in the world had more steel coasters in the top 50 than Kentucky Timber. And we're really proud of that. What makes that really ironic? Anybody know the answer to that? Why is that an odd fact? Yes, sir.
Could be a high restriction.
No, it's a good answer, but no, that's not. That we do have a high restriction. It's about 220 feet. That's why we're saving this land right here. What makes that odd? I don't know if you're all familiar with my background. I don't ride the rides ever. I have motion sickness. But who selects the rides? I do. So somehow, we managed to select rides that wound up in the top 50 in the world from a guy who never rides rides. Okay? I do that with a little help from our tech service guys, Bill Hardway and company. They help me with the selection of rides. We're very proud of that. But here's my question to you all, and you can help me with this. In 1990, Thunder Run was ranked the number one wood coaster in the world. In 1990, when we first put it in. Charlie Dinn's last roller coaster that he designed. You know, Charlie's the Beast. You guys know more about this than I do. And I noticed the Beast is still in the top six. I think it's ranked six in the wood coaster area. But Thunder Run is not on the list. Is there a reason for that? We've spent $2 million over the last 4 years, reprofiling the track, getting a new train. Is there something about Thunderbird I should know about that is not considered one of the top 50 really cars? Please, don't be shy. Help me out.
It's amazing.
Okay, I got amazing from Travis. Well, why is it not considered? Yes, young man, there he is. Say what? Well, why not?
Too rough.
Okay. Any particular part of the road that's rough?
Has he ridden it since he was on the track?
Couple of turns.
Okay. Have you ridden Holly Rolls or Wood Custom? Before you talk about that, I want to get some you know, there's a crazy thought, and I'm being very frank about this. There's a crazy thought that coaster enthusiasts really like rough with coasters. Yes, see, look at this. Look at this over there. You really like to be shaped, rattled, and rolled with coasters. The problem is, most guests don't like that experience. So maybe we actually be on a rough here. We think we're making it smoother, not rougher. So I guess that can make the world take different points of view. But we spent $2 million on that coaster. We continue to spend money every year to try to keep it as smooth as possible, given it to the world. Yes. I agree. I just think it's underappreciated, but maybe that's from a proud pop. Any questions you'll have on anything? I certainly appreciate your patronage. I'd love to see you all every single year. I know you stop by at different times during the year. I think you have some season pass holders here as well. We really appreciate your business. Very much so. Just let me open up to any questions you may have. I'm certainly happy to field them. And if not, just enjoy your... You got money? Yeah. What do you got? Oh, good. Okay.
Hello.
Hello. The volcano.
Yes.
Woo!
The Thunder Run is not too rough. It's definitely much better than it was before you refurbished it the last year. It's funny. I think the reason is that there's just a lot of people who only go to the parks and you just don't get enough voters to come down here and see how good it is.
Okay. That makes a lot of sense. That means you all have to do a better job at getting people to come to Kentucky Kingdom to enjoy Thunder Run.
Yeah, what you need to do is on the hill lift at Thunder Run and Holiday Road, you can put a sign up on the road to our
hill. Don't you love those feisty Kingdom folk? Those comments about Thunder Run. On that subject, about some of the bigger parks. I mean, listen, Holiday Road's a great facility. Kings Island's a premium facility. We're just fortunate to be part of the Midwestern theme park entourage, if you would. On that front, you know, in 2014 we opened up. We did a good attendance number. We only advertised in the Louisville market. In 2015, we extended our advertising to the outer markets. And we matched business. In 2016, we were up 41% in our attendance, which is a huge jump to be expected when we put in Storm Chaser. And this year, we're up over last year. Not 41%, but we're up, which is pretty good considering that we're going up against the Storm Chaser. So the word continues to spread about the Kingdom's quality, its good pricing, and we appreciate if you all spread that word as well, so maybe more people have an opportunity to ride Thunder Run as well. Yes, young man.
So I've ridden Thunder Run and Beast, and I think both the Beast and Thunder Run, they're rough, but the Beast doesn't hurt. Thunder Run does hurt a bit.
Okay, what is it about Thunder Run? Where do you get hurt on Thunder Run?
On some of the turns after the first airtime hills.
Yeah, that's exactly the area we're working this for. We're spending $250,000 and rework that area. Good observation. Have you ridden Thunder Run Ride, my ultimate defense?
I was there yesterday.
What do you think of the area?
It did hurt, but it was also pretty good.
Okay. Thank you for your honesty. We appreciate it. That's what we're going to do. Any other questions, Gary?
I'd like to suggest to the gentleman who just spoke, the next time you're at King's Island, ride the back seat of the Beast.
Okay.
It will hurt.
1990, and the only thing is that Thunder Run's been here since then. It's been untouched for untouched since 2015 up till now, since we reopened the park, and it's been sitting for so long that we just finally got redone and repainted everything. I mean, it's been here the longest ride. I mean, Dutchman's been since the park opened in Kings Island. So those two rides have been here the longest out of anything right here. I mean, T2's been here for a long time. But, you know, other rides used to be here have been gone since Six Flags took over, but hey, that sucked.
Okay.
But, you know, hey, I'm still having fun here. I mean, all the other parks you've been, like Cedar Fair Parks, they charge an arm and a leg. I mean, plus their rides are like 3 hours long. You have to buy like $100 fast pass to sit there and ride rides for 2 hours or even the whole day. You come here and ride flywheels for free almost, basically.
I like this man. Give him an extra hand.
Please use Raising Rabbits at Haunted House. It could use some good publicity.
Well, the Halloween thing is a whole other thing. People wonder why we don't have a Halloween program. You know, when we first did Halloween in the 1990s, we called it Hollow Scream, and it was a big event for us. But since then, you have so much competition in town during Halloween. You have so many more former holidays and so many more Halloween events. We're not sure it's really a wise investment, frankly. And our season passes are priced so competitively. If we had to put a Halloween program, we might have to raise the price of our season pass. I'd rather give them value in the counts during the season than come with a tangential show me season event. So that's an economic decision that I don't really know. We may consider it someday, but right now, we're in the country to do a Halloween. We do have intention, though, of celebrating our 30th anniversary, which is in 2019. 30th anniversary. As well as I do, it takes about 2 to 3 years to actually design, work out, locate the right next major attraction. So we're in the thick of that right now, and even Mark Brewer doesn't know what that attraction will be. He works it all the time. But we have something special planned for 2019, so stay tuned. Yes?
Going back to
step closer to the microphone so we can hear.
Thunder Run is smooth, but and the beast is jerky. But the beast is longer and higher. I understand you can't build that high. But that's one reason why the beast is better than Thunder Run.
You know what's interesting about that? I appreciate it. And listen, every experience on a roller coaster is very personal and subjective, right? If somebody likes it, somebody doesn't like it. But about height, I learned a lot about height when it comes to roller coasters. The tallest are not always the best. Take a look at Storm Chaser. All right, last year Storm Chaser was voted the number 2 best new ride in the world. And Storm Chaser is what, 120 feet tall. One of the things that lowering the height of a coaster, again, you probably know a lot more about this than I do, but lowering the height of a roller coaster allows you to react more quickly when you come down the drop. When you have a big, big drop, it takes a while to dissipate the energy, so you can't do a lot of quick motions right after the big drop. So the big drop is always extremely exhilarating and a lot of fun. It oftentimes is a one-trick pony. When it comes to a ride like Storm Chaser or Lightning Run, you can do a lot more twists and turns right away, which creates another form of excitement. So pick your poison. Big drop, exciting. Live action, also exciting. It's a very personal thing. But I appreciate your observation. Thank you. One more question if there's one. No, you already spoke. You can't go. You can't. I'm sorry. It doesn't work for me. Go to the microphone.
It works.
Go to the microphone. You already spoke. But you didn't spike to the microphone. We appreciate your growth.
Nighttime rides.
Say again.
Nighttime rides.
Nighttime rides, then okay. So that means I gotta spend what, maybe $2 or $3 million to light up the park in town. You know, it's funny, my teeth, I'm having fun with it. Don't need the lights, really. Tell our security force. Remember, all kidding aside, we love the fact that we're an urban park. We take that very seriously. We're an urban park. We employ white, black, brown, red team members from all over the community, all sections of the community, upper class, lower class, middle class. We're an urban park that serves everybody. With that comes certain challenges, because you're an urban park. Okay? We take those challenges very seriously. I think you'll agree, at least anybody who has a season pass that comes here frequently, we want a safe and a very clean park. It's not that easy. It's behind the scenes, believe me, our managers and directors work so hard to deliver that experience for you all. It's not, when it feels easy, we're doing a good job, but it's not easy. There's a lot of work and training that goes into it, just like there's a lot of work and training that goes into it. The certifying of our libraries or our lifeguards or what have you. But we're an urban park. Can you name one other urban park in America? I'm only aware of one. Village Gardens in Denver. Every other park is on the outskirts of a metropolitan area. But you generally have to drive through. It could be 20, 25, 30 minutes. Kings Island's in Mason. You can't just hop on a bus and go to that park like you can here in the metropolitan system. You gotta get into a car, you gotta get into your RV, whatever. We have a totally different challenge that we love and we absorb. We love our team members. We love the fact we employ 1,400 young people who work in this facility. So we're an urban park and we're proud of it. When you go to some of the other parks, look around. Just look around. And you see, they're not like Kentucky King. The nature of people they employ, the nature of the quality of the guests and all that stuff. So we're very proud of being one of America's few urban parks that can still deliver that same smile and that wonderful and safe atmosphere. You've heard me say this before. It's all about one thing. Make mom happy. Make mom happy. Sorry, guys. Make mom happy. We try to do that. Thank you so much. Have a great day. Good talking.